On 2019, the robotic spacecraft Chang'e 4 made a soft landing in the South Pole area of the Moon, otherwise known as the dark side of the Moon, the planet's only natural satellite. It is the first spacecraft in history to attempt or achieve landing on this unexplored area, which is never visible from Earth. China announced the successful landing and shared the first lunar images captured by the space probe via state media. As no direct communication link exists, the images had to be bounced off on another satellite before being relayed back to Earth. Following the demise of the Soviet Union's space program, the U.S. has enjoyed a period of unparalleled leadership in space. But in recent years, U.S. observers and politicians have warned that America's dominance could soon be challenged by China's fast-growing space capabilities. That concern has only deepened with a series of important and high-profile Chinese achievements. In 2020, it successfully put into orbit its final Baidu satellite, setting the stage to challenge the U.S. Global Positioning System, or GPS. On May 14, 2021, China safely landed a spacecraft on Mars for the first time in its history and in its first attempt, becoming the only other nation besides the U.S. to achieve such a feat. Its Zhurong rover, named after a god of fire from Chinese folklore, successfully landed in Utopia Planitia as part of the Tianwen-1 mission, according to the China National Space Administration. This particular breakthrough prompted NASA's new administrator, Bill Nelson, to warn against American complacency in face of China's space ambitions. At a House hearing, he held up an image taken by the Chinese rover on Mars, called China a very aggressive competitor, and lobbied Congress to fund NASA's plans to bring humans back to the Moon. Just like in the era of Sputnik and Apollo more than half a century ago, China and US are racing to achieve dominance in outer space. The geopolitics of space, once a frontier that brought rivals together for the good of humankind, are now mirroring the competition on Earth, pitting the US and its allies against China and Russia. How exactly China and the U.S. plans to accomplish these ambitions of landing on the Moon and setting up lunar base there for future exploration and mining. First, they need rockets. I mean big rockets to take them there. China is progressing with the development of 2 super heavy lift rockets for crewed missions and infrastructure launches to the Moon. The new launchers are designed to allow China to conduct short-term lunar landings before 2030 and send large pieces of infrastructure to the Moon in the 2030s, respectively. Progress on the rockets. A new generation crew launch vehicle and a super heavy lift launcher known as the Long March 9 has been moving ahead in an orderly manner. The rocket is based on technology and tooling developed for the Long March 5 heavy rocket variants that have launched China's space station modules, Mars mission, and a lunar sample return. The Long March 9 will boast a payload capacity of around 140 tons and will launch elements for the planned International Lunar Research Station, or ILRS, jointly planned by China and Russia. On the other side, NASA's Space Launch System, or SLS, will carry humans beyond the grasp of Earth's gravity, stretching to the Moon, Mars, and perhaps, one day, deep space. However, the first destination is the Moon. The new heavy-duty launch vehicle will be the world's most powerful rocket designed to carry and match payloads into deep space. Unlike any other space rocket, the SLS has been created to evolve alongside advancing technology. Its modular design and interchangeable pods means that it can evolve alongside growing technologies and varying mission goals. The International Lunar Research Station, or ILRS, is a complex, multi-phase megaproject that the China National Space Administration, or CNS, unveiled jointly with Russia in June 2021 in St. Petersburg, starting with robotic landing and orbiting missions in the 2020s. Its designers envision a permanently inhabited lunar base by the mid-2030s. ILRS will begin with a robotic reconnaissance phase running up to 2030, using orbiting and surface spacecraft to survey potential landing areas and resourcing. The phase will consist of Chinese missions Chang'e 4, Chang'e 6 sample return, and the more ambitious Chang'e 7, as well as Russian Luna spacecraft. Chang'e 7 will target a lunar South Pole landing and consist of an orbiter, relay satellite, lander, and rover. It will also include a small spacecraft capable of hopping to explore shadowed craters for evidence of potential water ice, resource that, if present, could be used in the future for both propulsion and supplies for astronauts. The completed ILRS would then host and support crew missions to the moon in around 2036. This phase, CNSS says, will feature lunar research and exploration, technology verification, and expanding and maintaining modules as needed. The last time humans went to the moon, it was a destination. But when NASA's Artemis 1 mission launches, the moon will be more of a station. Artemis is led by the US, with participation by the European Space Agency and many other friendly nations, including Australia and Canada. Artemis 1 is the program's first mission, and it will carry out a 42-day uncrewed test flight to orbit the moon and return to Earth. The trip will use a new launch vehicle, the Space Launch System, or SLS, which is the most powerful rocket currently operational in the world. On board will be mannequins made of materials replicating male and female biology. NASA will use the mannequins to test the comfort and safety of the launch vehicle and spaceflight capsule for humans. The second mission, Artemis 2, will follow a similar configuration to that of Artemis 1. This time, however, the Orion capsule will carry several astronauts into the region of space past the moon. Because of its human payload, during Artemis 2, the Orion capsule, along with the upper stage of the SLS, known as the Cryogenic Propulsion Stage or ICPS, will orbit the Earth twice, rather than the single orbit of Artemis 1 before heading moonward. NASA's Orion spacecraft is built to take humans farther than they've ever gone before. Orion will serve as the exploration vehicle that will carry the crew to space, provide emergency abort capability, sustain the crew during the space travel, and provide safe re-entry from deep space return velocities. Orion will launch on NASA's new heavy lift rocket, the Space Launch System. This is to ensure all systems are working optimally while the crew are still relatively close to Earth. The onboard crew will journey 4,600 miles beyond the far side of the moon before returning home. The mission is expected to last just over 10 days. The launch of Artemis 2 is scheduled for 2023 from NASA's Kennedy Space Center in Florida. Artemis 3 will be the second crewed mission of the Artemis program, and the first crewed lunar landing since Apollo 17 in 1972. It will be a mission lasting less than 30 days, and involve a short rendezvous of the Orion capsule with NASA's lunar orbital platform named Gateway, a space station in lunar orbit that will, by then, have been pieced together during 5 launches by private space companies under contract to NASA. Artemis 3 crew will include 4 astronauts. NASA has pledged the landing crew will include the first woman and the first person of color on the moon. It is planned to have 2 astronauts on the surface of the moon for about 1 week, while up to 4 astronauts would leave Earth on board Orion. The surface mission with the Human Landing System, or HLS, will consist of 2 crew members, who will remain on the surface for 6.5 days, and the 2 remaining astronauts will stay on board Orion. NASA selected SpaceX to develop Starship HLS and deliver it to the Gateway orbit prior to arrival of the crew for use on the Artemis 3 mission. 2 astronauts will transfer from Orion to Starship HLS, which will descend to the lunar surface and sustain them for several days, and then HLS will depart from the moon and return to the Gateway station to dock and transfer the 2 crews back to the Orion. Then all the crew reunited on board the Orion performs a lunar depart your burn and returns to Earth. There is some poetic perfection in NASA having chosen the name Artemis for this new lunar endeavor. Artemis is the Greek goddess of the moon, and the twin sister of Apollo, the namesake of NASA's 1960s moon spaceflight program. Artemis declared she never wanted to be married because she didn't want to become the property of any man. Why these superpowers are racing back to the moon when the US already won the race from Russia back in the 60s? Unlike Earth, the moon may contain large amounts of helium-3, an isotope potentially useful as an alternative to uranium for nuclear power plants because it's not radioactive. Chinese researchers are already looking for the element in moon rocks brought back to Earth in late 2020 by one of China's lunar missions. The resource there could be used to support long-term human habitation on and near the moon and lunar base, as well as permanent space stations orbiting the moon, such as NASA's planned Gateway and China ILRS. The moon could also prove valuable as a source of water, taken from ice at the lunar poles, to make rocket fuel that could power missions to Mars and other places in the solar system. A 1967 UN space treaty meant to start shaping the guardrails for space exploration bans anyone from claiming sovereignty over a celestial body, putting a military base on it, or putting weapons of mass destruction into space. Competition isn't necessarily a bad thing. It's like the World Cup. That simply means that each team and each side is going to push higher and faster. And as a result, humanity is likely to benefit.